For centuries, men have been viewed as the breadwinners of the family and often earn more than women doing the same job. Women who are stay-at-home moms are often undervalued and the contribution they make to the family isn't monetized. So today, we look at the relationship of women with money and discuss the myths, the facts, and what women can do to level the financial playing field. I'm Edric Mendoza and this is On The Money. Today, we have with us personal finance advocate, columnist, and author of best-selling book, Pinoy, Raising Pinoy Boys, Rose Frez Fausto. Hi, Rose.
Hi, Edric.
Welcome back to the show.
Yes, it's nice to be back.
Good to have you. This time, we're not going to talk about parenting so much, but more of women and their role in the workplace and money. So let's start off, and you know, maybe you can start us off by saying, what are the myths when it comes to women and making money in the workplace?
Yeah, probably number one there is that women are not good with money. Up to budget only.
Okay.
That's a myth. Because when you're dealing with money, you have to be very good with details. And generally speaking, women are better with details than men.
Where did that myth come from, I wonder?
Well, maybe because historically speaking,
right.
The woman was left at home to tend to the house, take care of the children, and the husband would be the one out there working and bringing home the bacon, so to speak. So, probably the exposure was not so much about the corporate
And earning and
negotiating your salary and all that. And another myth that I can think of is that women are not good investors. So it's quite related.
Similar that's why, to that history also, okay.
Yeah, so that's why they're just limited to the budget. But actually, there's this really funny book which says that Warren Buffett, the world's greatest investor, invests like a woman. And, you know, it was so nice because
context, it outlines like a woman.
There,
okay.
Yeah, it outlines there the general temperament of a woman, which actually makes for a good stock investor.
Okay, for example?
So we trade less.
Right.
And you know, if you're so malikot with your trading, you're just enriching your broker.
Too much activity.
You pay more fees, more commissions. And then we also exhibit less overconfidence. You know,
I mean, that's kind of true for men, right?
Men have to show some air of confidence.
Oh, look what I did, right? I
mean, so sometimes they imbibe that and become overconfident even in their investment decisions. Okay,
dangerous.
So women, we're probably more realistic
than that's true. I can see even with my wife, how we had the money. Yeah, I can see that.
We are more
realistic rather than overconfident.
Optimistic, yes. And then we have, of course, we don't have that much testosterone, so we are not
that
so willing. We're not so willing to go into great risks.
Is that good or bad? From an investment standpoint, not willing to go for great risks.
Well, because if you couple it with being realistic, then the women
and not overly confident, right? I see.
So
that's the dangerous
combo. And
then
let's just be very clear about it: the general temperament of not being over confident, not having testosterone,
right? Too much that pushes you to take all sorts of risks. Okay.
Yeah, and then of course, as I mentioned earlier, the details, the love for details. So you see the many aspects of one thing, and probably you exert more effort into the research and all that. So actually, women out there should embrace this general characteristics and even use it to be great investors.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's good. Okay, I understand. Sure. I'm secure, so I can hear.
This is very good.
Okay. So those would be temperaments that would be good for
an investor. Yes.
Okay. What other myths? Any others?
Any other that I can think of? Probably that.
Investment budgeting.
Yes.
Okay. What about borrowing money and things like that?
That one. But I don't think that's a myth. It's already established that we lenders are better off lending to women borrowers.
Really?
It's not a myth anymore. Mm-hmm. It's been established.
It's a known fact.
Yes.
How so? Yeah.
These microfinance institutions, they now target the women, the wives, the mothers of the lower income families, because the repayment record of these women, it's a lot better. Yes.
Whereas the men would squander it. That's what I hear. No, is that true? Okay, that's good to know. Now, tell me. Earlier we said that women and men, job on job, generally, right? Men make more than women. Can you give me your two cents? Why is that?
Why is that? Mm-hmm. Again, historically, because the men are supposed to be the breadwinner. So the expectation for men to earn is also there. And probably because women joined the workforce a lot later on historically, right? And imagine yourself as an employer.
Sure.
So you now have these two applicants, what we call ceteris paribus in economic terms.
Right, right.
All things being equal,
yes, at par, yeah.
Who would you choose? Let's just be honest.
Which has happened in my own business, right? Men.
Yeah, and
for reasons you will explain, because
men will not get pregnant.
That's right. Will not take leaves for their kids.
Yes, who is the default parent to take a leave when there's an emergency at home, when the child gets sick, when a parent should attend a ceremony or a game. So it's the mother. So, you know, if you have a capitalist mentality, you'd go for the man, right?
You get more days that they can be with you.
Yes,
yeah,
that's
okay.
Right.
So that's possibly why you're saying from employability perspective. No, okay. So since that's the mindset, are there any ways that women can, if this is their situation, what they can do to get equal pay? I mean, assuming talent on talent is the same?
Well, you just have to work a little bit harder.
Really?
Is that's that it? That's sad. Yeah, no,
they
it,
can't
you know what?
Talk with the boss and negotiate. I mean, there's no... what if the boss is a woman?
Sometimes
is
it's
that
harder
possible?
To have a lady boss.
Are you serious? Okay.
What we should probably mention here in connection with that is that since you already have a lower income, generally speaking, and then you also have a shorter period of time to accumulate from your profession.
Why?
And why is that? Mm-hmm. Because if you get married, you know, who's the parent who's going to give up his or her career? It's the her career.
Generally, right?
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm talking from experience, but of course it was a well thought out and willingly taken decision on my part. No pressure whatsoever. So you have lower salary, you have a shorter time to accumulate money, and then you have a longer life.
Okay, yeah, that is fact. Our NSO shows, right?
Yes.
Women are outliving men in
so
the Philippines.
So you should always, always be very keen on knowing how to handle money, because all these things,
right,
and these are general things, but they're really out there. We experience this. They should really make you really think twice and be good with money. You should be good with money if you're a woman.
That's a good perspective. So rather than focusing, you're saying, rather than focusing on
Kawawa
what can I do about
ako,
my pay, this person is a man, and just because he's a man, he's getting better, just make the most of what you are earning. You know, prudently practice prudent fiscal management, right?
Yes.
Because as you mentioned, shorter span,
longer
life. So focus on what you are doing with what you actually have.
Yes, and before you leave that job of yours, that lucrative job of yours, you better have a heart-to-heart talk with your husband.
Right.
Your money, your salary
makes
is not
sense.
Just yours, honey.
Right.
It's ours.
But for people who might be struggling with this right now, there's really no practical principles we can give them, no? When
what
it comes to employee A sees employee B, same position, the other person gets the promotion, even if she feels like she's deserving or she gets less pay. What to do?
You know, that's very tricky, because you cannot impose and you can only argue with performance. To me, that's the only
way.
You
so
can
that's
only
why you said earlier, work harder and show that you can deliver. Okay. So let's talk about bringing this now to the home. Do you think women are involved enough in the home family finances, like managing money, taking care of budgets? What are your thoughts on that?
Taking care of budgets, in fact, that's more of a burden given to them than
default. So it's a common thing. Okay.
Yes, yes. So
it is not a disputable area,
is
right?
Given
right.
to them, especially for housewives. You know, a reader wrote to me once asking, and I wrote an article about this, which I entitled "Honey, My Allowance, Please," because she was asking
Thank
me
you. Right, right,
she,
okay.
if she should be asking for her allowance already, because she has been married for over a decade already, but she never handled their money. The husband is
she never got any money to use on her own.
Yes.
Wow. Okay.
So well, because she stopped working right after they got married, and the husband is a good provider. Provider. He has a lucrative business, and he takes care of all the expenses, maybe even her salon expenses and all that. But then maybe there's this interest in handling money directly.
On her own, no?
Yes, on her own. That's why her question was, should I ask for my allowance
A discretionary
now?
Oh, what did you say?
I said yes,
right.
And of course, but you have to break it to him gently, honey.
Right, honey, I want my money now. That's going to be a problem. Okay.
Yeah. So you know these things. The reason is that sometimes money is a taboo topic, but it shouldn't be. In fact, you should have discussed it before you even got married. So maybe you could talk about financial goals and then tell him that you want to be involved more actively, and it should not only open the discussion about allowance, but really lay down on the table, honey, what do we really have? Mm-hmm. Because anyway, it's community of property. Whatever mm-hmm. he owns, she owns.
That makes sense.
If
yeah.
you got married in 1988, I think, it's not anymore conjugal. Huh? Mm. This one is more encompassing the community property. Everything that you own, even the ones you owned prior to the marriage,
becomes
it goes into
owned
the
by
pool.
The couple, right?
Yes. And so it's really very important for the woman to know, the wife to know, because what if he goes?
Of course.
She wouldn't know.
Wouldn't know where to go, what sort of expenses, what sort of money they have. That's a great principle. So lay it down and ask for a discretionary fund in a planning mode, sort of, right? Oh, you know, what's our plan? Maybe you can disclose it to me. Excellent. I think that one of the last questions we'll probably ask in this segment is, is it true that there aren't as many female investors? Why or why not?
Yes, and again, it goes back because of the history.
I see. Okay.
So you hire the male
more
than the female.
Makes sense. Okay, we're going to have more questions for you from our viewers, Rose.
Sure.
This is a very, you know, exciting topic, if
and
you will.
And controversial.
Right, and controversial. So stay tuned with us on The Money. We'll be right back. Welcome back to On The Money. Let's check what Salve Duplito has for us in Salve Says.
How much salary should a stay-at-home mom get? The answer to this very interesting question is very important for financial planning. We need it to figure out just how much life insurance coverage she needs, for example. We need it to appreciate the women who bring so much into our lives.
To find the true cost of a stay-at-home mom, experts say we simply get the best cost of everything she does if we are to hire someone else to do them. Some obvious costs include babysitter or yaya, all-around maid, cook, driver, laundry, gardener, or tutor. There are less obvious costs, though, that we need to include in the list. Personal shopper, accountant, event planner, and even psychologist. In fact, one expert said you also have to add the cost of a high-end escort service at the end of the day. Stay-at-home mom should be paid a senior management official's salary. So take care of her, get a good life insurance coverage for her, and include simple pampering in her monthly budget. And make sure mom can retire well.
There's a lot of discussion on the cost of raising a child. It's time we all appreciate the true cost of a woman and a mother.
Still with us is personal finance advocate, best-selling author, and columnist Rose Fausto. And of course, with us is Melissa Hecole with Your Money Questions. Hi, Mel.
Hi, Edric, and welcome back, Rose.
Yes, good to be here again.
Topic.
I love this topic. Be ready.
I'm ready. Here we go. Let's go.
That's right. Okay. Rosalind Sumalapao says, if women earn more than men, is this an issue?
Boom.
What do you think?
Yeah. Theoretically, it shouldn't be an issue.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But culturally, the reality is we are still very traditional. We still expect the husband to be bringing home the bacon.
Mm-hmm. More bacon.
Yes, more bacon.
Right.
So the key to that is really to discuss it and bring out all the issues. For a guy to be able to have a great marriage, even if he earns less than the wife, he should really have a great self-esteem.
Yeah,
I'm not measured by my salary, honey.
Yeah, yeah, I think that's right. I think that's the main issue that comes up is self-esteem.
That's right.
With men when their wives are earning more than them.
Mm-hmm.
And if you can tackle that, then you're okay,
then let
right?
them talk,
mm-hmm.
right?
The other day, you were saying actually that when women earn more than men,
right.
usually that is when the accounts are separate.
Yes, you know, probably, I'm just guessing. Maybe the pride of the husband, he would say, okay, that's your money, take care of it. So.
I see. So how do they separate their accounts then?
Most of the time, they would assign which expense goes to which spouse. So, and okay, you know, it's not very
who
easy
handles
to,
what, who pays
yeah,
for
so
what.
So you mm-hmm. pay for the tuition, I pay for the utilities, you pay for the mortgage, mm-hmm. whatever mm-hmm. Arrangement they would like to have. But it's not very practical, well, in my perspective, because the salary increases of each spouse is not the same, of both spouses are not the same. Mm-hmm. So what if the one spouse is already shouldering a lot, but then his
that
salary
makes it,
is
yeah.
just there. So
yeah,
it has to, it's
right.
really
right.
more efficient.
Yeah.
It's really more efficient to pull right. it together.
That's right.
Because anyway, right. what he owns, this is what the women yeah. usually say. What he owns, I own. But what I own,
of course, I own also, right? I don't agree with that. Yeah. Well, so I wanted to throw just a question because you know when we counsel some couples mm-hmm. in marriage, what if wife is a mom? Mm-hmm. And she is making more than the husband, but because she's working so hard, she's neglecting the children, neglecting the home. What are your thoughts there?
Oh,
is that
husband.
An issue then?
Oh, that's a big issue. Personally speaking,
sure.
yeah, I was contributing half of the family income when I felt that I wasn't happy anymore because I wasn't mm-hmm. able to spend a lot of time with my very young kids. Mm. So we talked about it. We did some pencil pushing with our expenses, did a lot of prayer over it, mm-hmm. and
We finally decided.
I finally
and did it
decided.
Work out for you guys?
Very well.
Okay.
So and that's why there's
right,
no
right.
book.
Right, there's a book. Okay. So maybe that's
so,
what maybe...
So you decided yeah. to give up your job? Is that what you're saying? Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
But the key here is that my husband, I hope that everybody has a husband like my husband, because he never...
Suddenly, right?
Well.
No. Secure.
He never made me feel that what he was earning is his alone.
There
it was
go.
Always
good husband.
Yes.
It's always
well, yes.
A family
if you're
earning.
Going to give up your job, you can't then have a husband.
Of course, we'll say it's all me.
He says, "Well, then it's all me because whatever. You made that decision together."
There
yes, that's right.
Well said, Mel.
Okay.
So that's a consideration for Roslyn, mm-hmm. right?
Okay. Great. Now, Lev Mateo says, "Who should hold the money for the budgeting in the family?
Whoever is better with it."
Okay.
Good advice.
Yeah,
agreed.
Yeah, you
right.
always have to check what your strengths and weaknesses are, mm-hmm. and then make use of your strengths mm-hmm. for
okay.
the benefit of the family.
Right. Follow-up question. Should there be an end accountability? Like, let's say wife is really better at the details and budgeting, right? But if things go wrong, do you think that there should be an end accountability? Like, whoever is the earning or whoever is, should there be something like that?
What do you mean?
Like, for example, we had another guest who mm-hmm. the husband would make the major decisions.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and then all the other day-to-day main budgeting decisions would be the wife. Should there be a system like that for couples, or not necessarily? What are your thoughts?
Again,
whatever works for them. Angie Lynn Medina asks, is it a good idea for a couple to have their own savings and money set aside for themselves and one separate account where they share equally, which would then be the fund for all their expenses?
Okay, when you said I do, mm-hmm. I do bequeath all my properties.
That's part of it, right?
Okay.
So it's really a common pool of properties. Mm-hmm. That's what you should always remember, no matter what these
right,
two spouses
right.
do. Everything is really in the pool. Mm-hmm. But again, probably for some people, it's better to have a discretionary fund so that you don't always have to ask permission. Or can I go to the salon?
That's
can
also
I
right,
advice,
exactly.
Yeah.
And I think it varies from couple to couple. I think having separate accounts for certain things is fine. If it works for you, it works
mm-hmm.
for you.
That's right, to each his own.
Yeah, that's right. So I think that, yeah, exactly, discretionary fund. Maybe decide what expenses you're going to split. Have that joint account together.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Each contribute an equal percentage of your salary to it so that nobody feels bad that one is contributing more
mm-hmm.
because you don't have, like you said, you don't have equal salaries.
Yeah.
So if that percentage is based on the amount you're making, goes into
equitable.
The,
yeah.
then it's very fair.
Yeah.
It's all a matter of communication.
Yeah, and disclosure,
we
right?
We cannot even advise, oh, the percentage would be like this.
Right.
Yeah.
You have to talk about
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
And some people feel like they do want their own money,
mm-hmm.
even though it,
yeah.
is all conjugal
yeah.
property
discretionary
sure.
fund, yeah.
You
yeah.
know, some people
some
just want to know
liberty
they have
probably.
This. Yeah, that's
I have control over this amount. I can do whatever I want, right? The
yes.
fun fund.
Yes.
The fund
yes.
money.
Psychologically,
yeah.
they just like that.
Mm-hmm.
So if that works.
Sure.
Yes, go ahead.
Makes sense.
Great.
Have your fun fund.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now, Angela says, help me understand a woman's psyche when it comes to shopping. Why can't women resist buying another pair of shoes or another style of bag when they already have a lot of these anyway?
Boom, another one.
Oh,
here we go, let's answer this. Ladies.
Okay, well, first of all, I cannot quite relate to that because I'm not really a big shopper. However,
neither is my wife, yeah.
However, you should always remember that women were always expected to look our best.
That's right? True. If your man expects you to look your best, then support he it. Should also be able to support you.
I agree with that. I can't argue with that. That makes sense.
And it's also nice to always look your best. You know, you get some form of respect, better treatment.
Confidence.
Yes, mm-hmm. Confidence.
Self-esteem.
And let's just face it, there is an email defect in each of us. even men. Yeah.
You know what that is right now.
Yeah. So, I was actually, the first thing that came to mind was Imelda.
That's already in the dictionary, by the
way. It is in the dictionary, Imelda. So I think the question is, what is your best? Because one woman might say, well, I need to have this versus
it's what you can afford.
There you go. That's
it's
a good point.
It's what you can
point,
afford. It's right? what you value.
Because they might start pulling out loans and say, well, they said my
you
best,
should,
right?
Yeah.
Mel said.
Rose and Mel said, right? They quote you on you the should, money, you know? Rose and Mel. Edric just nodded his head.
Never go into debt shopping for shoes, bags.
Whatever
those are
you
just
can afford.
Whatever you can afford. Without sacrificing the college fund of your kids.
And other things, right?
And other things.
That's right. So, yeah, I don't think all women are like that. I think that's actually incorrect to say.
Yes, in fact, we were talking about it earlier, that it's actually a caricature.
It is.
That women are
Sex
just
in the
big
City.
Shoppers.
That TV show, that's propagated media, this right. idea that we are shoe
it's
and
a connivance
bagaholic.
With the commercial.
So tell me again, that's a stereotype, right? That's a stereotype.
Totally.
It's a caricature,
it's
actually.
A caricature. Yes. Not even, it's not even real, right?
That's right. Now, okay. We asked our friends in social media their thoughts on this topic, and Yoli Escobar says, it is just right that the wife should demand, take note, demand to apportion 75% of all his earnings to his full-time housewife and give his wife a bonus from his 13th month pay. Mahirap yata ang maging housewife at katulong in most cases. So true, Yoli.
Well, your thoughts,
75%. And what is the basis of that? It should be 100%.
That's what I was going to say. No, seriously. That's what I was going to say. I mean, really, if you think about it, if you read our merit, everything, you own everything. Yeah, so 100%, right?
Yeah. But yes, it's true, though. You know, women who are full-time housewives, it's very hard for them to monetize what they contribute.
Their work. Mm-hmm.
That's right. And they work 24/7. Mm-hmm. The work that they do for that family is immeasurable.
Yes.
It really is. Mm-hmm. They're taking care of the kids. They are managing the household budget. Mm-hmm. They are taking care of their husband. Mm-hmm. They're running the entire household. They're running your life.
Awesome.
Okay.
I think about my wife. So that's exactly how I tell her, you know what, hon, everything I have is yours.
That's you're great.
So good. I'm going to support you, you know, if you need anything. I try my best. Okay, I'm not always like that. But yeah, I agree completely.
Yeah, because anyway, we go back again. Yeah. When you said, I do bequeath everything.
Everything, right?
So again, it's a matter of open communication.
Agreed.
Yeah. And well just think, what are you going to be paying a nanny? Mm-hmm. What are you going to be, and that's full-time live-in nanny. What are you going to be paying a teacher? Because that's what a mom does also at home. And that's
especially if they're homeschooling.
That's right.
Exactly.
You know, what are you going to be paying all these people to do all these things that you were doing as a housewife? Cooking, cleaning, caring for the kids, preparing their meals.
You know, I think it's
driver
priceless.
Also, if you're the ones taking them to school and everywhere
else. If you do the massaging.
I agree. I mean, you do everything. I mean, there is no value. It's probably the most expensive job in the world if you think about
Maybe the vision should really be, it's a whole, it's a unit. It's, for example, if you'd like
Rose.
To take it like a company, so all the income, all the revenues goes into the company,
right.
And then you have your own roles.
Right.
So there's really no need to
everyone's contribution
put,
is vital.
You don't really need to put a value to the nannying duties.
Each specific thing, though.
Now, there have also been comments on Facebook about how men earn more than women doing the same job. What can women do to change this? I mean, I know women can't change this on our own. It has to be everybody. But what do you think women can do to kind of get things moving in this?
Well, as we talked about it earlier, you can only argue with your performance.
Mm-hmm. But unless what if your performance is the same?
Unless you want to take your employer to court. Because that's
well,
the only reason that I can think of. Mm-hmm. You know, you argue with performance. And then if they don't give it to you still, then you go to court.
Yeah, so you do a side-by-side to your employer. Look, I'm doing the exact same thing as Joe here, and yet I'm getting paid 25% less.
But after suing your employer, would you still want to stay there? And he's going to hire you again. Right.
Well, no, hopefully we won't get as far as that. But just the side-by-side comparison might make them actually see. That's right.
So you always argue with performance again. It's the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Okay, anyway, send us your money questions via email or through Facebook and Twitter, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our next Q&A Friday.
Whew, we survived that discussion. That's very good. I mean, like you said, perspective is very important, right? And in marriages, when in the case, honesty, transparency, and where you can side by side. Okay, that's our show today. I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again tomorrow for more talking tips so you're always right on the money.